Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. Google has Apple, Samsung, and other tablet makers in its sights. The company debuted a $200 7-inch tablet Wednesday called Nexus 7 at its Google I/O conference. It'll run on Android 4.1, dubbed Jelly Bean. Built with ASUS, the tablet can be ordered on Google Play this week and will ship in the US and three other countries in mid-July. The tablet has a 1280 by 800 pixel display and a Tegra 3 chipset with a quad-core CPU and 12-core GPU. We caught up with a Consumer Electronics Association analyst, and while the tablet market is still growing, as market penetration increases, growth will slow.
I think we see the growth rate moderate a bit. Looking at consumer electronics, we saw sales at about 8% in nominal terms last year. We'll probably still see single digits this year, lower single digits, I think, as some of the real growth categories, tablets and smartphones, recede just a little bit. Still will be very positive and will be big drivers for growth this year, just not quite to the extent that they were last year in terms of pure growth percentages.
Google also introduced a spherical Android-based device called Nexus Q that will work in homes to distribute music and other content over stereos with controls from Android smartphones and tablets. Google Play will launch on the home screen of the new tablet, and buyers will get a $25 credit towards Google Play content. Given the price and focus on content streaming from Google Play, analysts said the Nexus 7 tablet will principally serve the same audience as the Kindle Fire, a $199 7-inch device that Amazon is expected to update in July. The EU General Court rejected Microsoft's appeal of a 2008 European Commission antitrust ruling, but reduced the fine by 40 million euro. The record-breaking penalty was imposed after Microsoft failed to disclose API information that would allow competitors to develop interoperable products.
1. Fixes the amount of the periodic penalty payment imposed on Microsoft Corp in Article 1 at 860 million euro.
The court ultimately reduced the fine by 4% after it took into account a 2005 letter from the Commission, allowing Microsoft to continue certain restrictions on particular rival products, pending a ruling on an open case. Microsoft is the only company to be fined by the European Commission's antitrust regulators for failing to comply with an order. Two of Japan's main airlines, All Nippon Airways and Japan Airlines, will begin providing Wi-Fi on some international flights as early as next month. JAL will offer Wi-Fi between Tokyo and New York for $22 a day. ANA will go live in the middle of next year, initially on its 777 and 767 aircraft. ANA didn't say whether it would offer it on the Boeing 787 Dreamliner. Despite the early promise of such services, Wi-Fi has yet to become mainstream for airlines and passengers, in part due to the cost. Outfitting a single plane with the service can cost an airline more than $100,000, making some companies wary, and passengers have been unwilling to pay when other entertainment is available often for free. Sony and Panasonic said Monday they'll team up to create mass production technology for its super high-res TVs based on OLED technology. They're hoping it'll drive mainstream adoption and revive their struggling TV businesses. They want to develop an effective way to print large panels that use OLEDs by next year. Sony launched the world's first OLED TV in 2007, an 11-inch model that was just 3 millimeters thick at the screen and wowed consumers but cost over $2,000. A quick programming note, take a look on our channel for the latest IDG app review. We take a look at iTunes alternatives, including DoubleTwist, Spotify, Google Play, and others. If you have an app you want us to review, shoot us an email. And if you've done a review yourself, let us know, and we might use it on our next show. First, it was social networking that made its way into the enterprise. Now it's gaming. Companies exhibiting at Enterprise 2.0 last week here in Boston bet big that their gamification platforms could create more engaged and productive workers. Gamification is a new trend in the enterprise and can be largely attributed to the consumerization of IT.
As with anything kind of Enterprise 2.0, I think a lot of folks have been watching what happens in, quote unquote, the consumer space for the next innovation. I think that's one aspect.
Before gamifying its site, Samsung.com had a difficult time keeping customers there because it doesn't sell its products direct. By rewarding customers who write reviews, watch demonstrations, and the like, it gives them an incentive to stay on the site longer and revisit often. IBM gamification partner Bunchball said that its customers that used gamification saw complex software products adopted 4 times faster than without gaming. A call center saw training time shrink from 4 weeks to just 14 hours. Shipment of the XO-3 tablet has been delayed as one laptop per child finalizes the design and seeks partners to make the product. The XO-3 tablet has an 8-inch screen and will be offered as an educational tool for children in developing countries. The XO-3 was first announced in late 2009, and working units were shown earlier this year at the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas. The tablet is tapped to be priced around $100 and was scheduled to become available earlier this year. It's not as thin or as fast as the iPad, but has features that could be helpful to people in developing nations. The internal battery can be charged by solar panels or hand cranks, and the organization is trying to determine if the battery can be detached and the tablet powered directly through a solar cell. The tablet provides about 8 to 10 hours of battery life. Well, that's our show for this week. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. Next week, we have a summer special planned for you. I'll be at the beach testing out some summer products, so it's a show you won't want to miss. As we head out this week, we'll leave you with some shots from Google I.O., where skydivers live stream their fall to Earth. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching, and we hope to see you at the beach next week.